A very good morning and welcome to the 33rd and final meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2022. There are no apologies this morning, and just for the record, our final agenda item this morning, which was consideration of the committee's action plan, it will be rescheduled to a future meeting. So our first item of business today is an oral evidence session on the criminal justice provisions within the National Care Service Scotland Bill. And members will recall on the 23rd of November, we heard from a panel of witnesses on the possible transfer of justice social work services from local government to the proposed National Care Service. And today we'll conclude our consideration by hearing from the Scottish Government. So I welcome to the meeting this morning Kevin Stewart, Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care, Anna Kinniston, Deputy Director of the National Care Service, and Ms. Katrina Dalrymple, Deputy Director of Community Justice at the Scottish Government. So welcome to you all. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I intend to allow about 60 minutes for this session. So I'd now like to invite the Minister to make a short opening statement, and then we'll move straight on to questions. Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee, and thank you for having me along today to give evidence. It's fair to say that the National Care Service is one of the most ambitious reforms of public services. It will end the postcode lottery of care provision across Scotland and ensure that those who need it have access to consistent and high-quality care and support to enable them to live a full life wherever they are. People with experience of receiving social care support and providing it have been clear that there is an urgent need for change. The NCS Bill sets out a framework for the changes that we want to make and allows scope for further decisions to be made. This flexibility enables the NCS to develop, adapt and respond to specific circumstances over time. The principles of any new system will be person-centred, with human rights at the very heart of social work and support. No decision has been made yet on whether justice social work will be included in the National Care Service, but we are making provision to enable it and considering what is the best approach. I acknowledge that unlike care, justice social work has the unique feature of being court-ordered, placing requirements on those in contact with the service and adding different practical considerations. To fully support those involved in the justice system, a holistic approach which recognises the links between offending and other care and support needs is required, whether justice is included in the NCS or not. The work in progress will collate evidence, work with partners to develop options for the future of justice, and include a public consultation at the end of 2023, which is a result of the feedback from stakeholders in the consultation. Justice social work staff and people with lived experience will be central to our programme of work. The NCS will bring changes that will benefit the workforce too. The importance of staff in the social work and social care sector has never been clearer, and we are fully committed to improving their experience as we recognise and value the work that they do. We are committed to co-designing and working with people with first-hand experience of accessing and delivering social work and social care to ensure that we have a person-centred National Care Service that best fits the needs of the people who will use and work in its services, with human rights at its very centre. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much indeed, Minister. So we'll now just move on to questions, and if I may, I'll just start with an opening question. And Minister, obviously you acknowledged in your opening statement the sort of specific role that criminal justice social work or justice social work has in our courts, among other settings. And with that in mind, you'll be aware of the forthcoming bail and release from custody bill that the committee is just beginning to consider, and it includes a provision whereby justice social work could have a greater role in providing courts with information to inform decisions around bail. And to date, the evidence that we've taken from witnesses, both in oral evidence and in written evidence, suggests, perhaps not surprisingly, that this will potentially see a greater justice social work resource requirement. So I'm just wondering if you could perhaps outline your sort of view on what might be the best model, bearing in mind I appreciate we're at a very early stage, but perhaps an optimum model for justice social work going forward, that so whether it would be, for example, to remain within local authorities or actually for it to move to a care service setting.
Thank you, Convener, and I think that's a very pertinent question. And, you know, I'm not a great expert in the bail and release from custody bill, but I will give some detail around about that in this answer. But I think the key thing in all of this, as I said earlier, no decision has been taken around about whether criminal justice social work is in or out of the National Care Service. The Cabinet will take a decision at that at a later point after all the work that we are doing is complete. But whether in or out, there has to be connections. And we have to make sure that those connections are right and that all of this works for people. Because at the end of the day, some of the scrutiny of this bill has been around about structure. But the realities are what we're all striving to achieve, no matter what, is good outcomes for people. So no matter whether in or out, we have to make sure that those connections are right. The Bail and Release from Custody Bill, as the committee will be well aware, is in three parts which focus on two separate stages of the criminal justice system in Scotland. Part one focuses on how custody is used as part of bail and remand decision-making in Scottish courts and will, amongst other matters, reform the legal framework within which courts make decisions in individual cases regarding the use of bail and remand as part of a criminal court process. Part two focuses on how certain release from prison custody mechanisms operate, with an emphasis on increasing opportunities for improved reintegration of people leaving prison and improving the support provided to them and released to reduce the risk of reoffending. And the bill also makes provision to provide information on prisoner release to victim support organisations and introduces a permanent power of executive release in emergency situations. In part three, which covers some of the areas that you described in your question, Convener, is split into four distinct areas. And the one that you are most interested in this morning, I think, is that enhanced role for justice social work in provision of information to the court. Also, there's the reform to the legal framework within which bail decisions are made, the recording of reasons when bail is refused, and how periods on electronically monitored bail conditions affects time served for custodial sentences. But I think the main thrust of your question and the main thing that we're looking at today is that enhanced role for justice social work in the provision of information to the court. And the bill, of course, has taken account of that additional work and the resource required. One of the things, Convener, I think, which is beneficial here is that enhanced role. But we also have to make sure that the enhanced role for criminal justice social workers matches with some of the other roles that social workers have in wider community settings here. So let me give you an example, because I think it's always best to do that, in a way which shows that, you know, we haven't got the linkages sometimes quite right here, and why, no matter in or out, that linkages have to be better. So we have come across, and the committee will be well aware, that myself, officials have been talking to a huge amount of folks, listening to the voices of lived experience about their feelings around about social work, social care and support. And one of the folks that we have listened to is a young guy who is at risk of offending, who at the moment has 15 different interventions going on. And those are not necessarily linked. And I think it would be fair to say, from hearing what this young man said, that sometimes he feels like he's being put from pillar to post. And he doesn't know really who to trust in terms of the advice that he is receiving. Now, these are the kind of situations that no matter whether in or out, we have to do better in terms of outcomes for people. So again, you know, we have that job of work to do to create much better linkages between criminal justice social work, family, children's and family social work, and others, and the care support in order to get that right for individuals. And that's why we're embarking on the work that we are doing in terms of research and data gathering, and most importantly, listening to the voices of lived experience in order that we get that right as we move forward.
Thanks very much. That's a very comprehensive sort of response. I think, and you've covered a lot within that. Just following on from that, what I'd like to do is refer to the evidence, the written evidence that we received from Claire Wilson. So Claire is a chief social work officer in Aberdeen City Council. And in considering, the question around whether or not it would be better to address the issues within the system before essentially sort of introducing a new level of management, i.e. a care service model, her comments were that what would be beneficial, and I'm just putting this to you, is to pause the bill in terms of justice to enable a review of the current system, co-design a new one, and then a careful transition over to the National Care Service once the social care part is established and arrangements are in place. Now, I suppose, bearing in mind that we have the Bail and Release Bill coming down the track, as you have alluded to, and the potential increase in workload that will bring to justice social work, I'm just interested in what your thoughts are about the comments and the sort of suggestion, if you like, that Ms Wilson made in her written evidence.
Convener, as I've kind of outlined already, the establishment of the National Care Service will have an impact on community justice partners, whether justice social work is included or not in NCS and the National Social Work Agency. This reflects that many community justice partners rely on effective communication and collaboration, as I've already outlined, with other partners across health and care. And I have to say, and I cannot reiterate this enough this morning, that community justice partners are actively involved in the work to inform a decision on justice social work. And that will make certain that the options appraisal will fully consider the implications and opportunities for improvements across community justice as well as justice social work specifically. So we're doing this work, convener. We will still look to improve before the establishment of the National Care Service. We will still seek to improve whether justice social work is in or out, because, as I say, we have got to get those linkages absolutely right. Now, I've heard a number of calls for pauses to the National Care Service Bill or elements within the National Care Service Bill. But what I would say to the committee, as I've said to the Health Committee yesterday, is that for many people, They want to see all of this moving at pace. And I have to strike the right balance in what we are doing here. And I think that, you know, that balance is about right. You know, Derek Feely himself, who, excuse me, was the chair of the Independent Review into Adult Social Care, who suggested that and recommended that we establish a national social work agency, said that all of this should move at pace. And there are many other stakeholders out there, particularly the voices of lived experience, who want all of this to have happened yesterday. Now, I get the points that people make around about some of their feelings around about that pace of change. But, you know, pausing this is not going to stop the work that we need to do anyway to ensure the best outcomes for people. And NCS, as far as I'm concerned, is the best way forward.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Minister. OK, so I'm just going to move straight to questions and invite members to come in. And I'm going to bring in Katie Clark and then Fulton McGregor. Katie.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. How do you do? The Feely Review focused on adult social care. So where did the idea of bringing wider social work functions into the National Care Service come from?
Well, Derek Feely did concentrate on adult social care in his review, but he also made recommendations around about National Social Work Agency. What we found in terms of our initial listening to people was that many folks felt that bringing in adult social care into the National Care Service only was not enough and may actually lead to difficulties in terms of transition points and, you know, cause problems in terms of linkages, as I've outlined. So that's why we consulted in bringing other things into the National Care Service in that consultation. However, you know, we have always said that the work that was done in terms of Derek Feely's report went into in-depth, very in-depth, around about adult social care. And we recognise that if we are to bring community justice, children's services in, we needed to have the evidence base to do that. And that's why we have carried out, or are carrying out, the research, options appraisals, and of course listening to stakeholders, which is the most important thing, around about whether these services should be in or out. And as I've explained to the convener already this morning, Ms Clark, you know, whether in or out, we have to make sure those linkages are right. So that research, that options appraisal and listening to stakeholders will be of benefit no matter whether these services are in or out of National Care Service.
I appreciate there was mention of this in the government consultation, but it's quite clear when we've spoken to social workers and indeed other people that are involved in the sector that they feel there hasn't been a proper consultation, there hasn't been a full consultation. So why wasn't that fuller consultation carried out with social workers, with people with lived experience and others before coming to the Parliament with the bill? And don't you think that there's a need to carry out that full consultation before the Parliament actually considers the issue?
We have said that we will consult on these issues after the research, the option appraisal and listening to stakeholders. We have committed to doing that. But what I would say to Ms Clark and to others in the committee, we didn't suddenly pluck this out of the air and decide that all of this should be in National Care Service. What we did was we listened to the voices of lived experience. Listened to their views around about their thinking in terms of what they wanted to see out of the National Care Service. And, you know, I think you're right to say that some stakeholders have said that the evidence base for bringing in criminal justice, children's services, is not as great as it was from the independent review carried out by Derek Feely and the recommendations from that review. But again, Derek Feely has pointed out in that review around about linkages too. And, you know, that's why we are conducting all of the work that we're doing at this moment. It's why we've not made a decision around about whether children's services are in or out, because we want that evidence base and we want to listen to stakeholders. So to give you an example of how stakeholders are involved in informing this decision at this moment, officials have established a reference group which is meeting regularly to provide and inform and support the programme of work. And this group consists of stakeholders, including COSLA, Community Justice Scotland, the Scottish Association of Social Workers, Social Work Scotland, the Risk Management Authority, the Victims Organisation Collaboration Forum Scotland, the Office of the Chief Social Work Advisor, and the Care Inspectorate. And these partners, these research partners, will work directly with Justice Social Work staff and their clients to obtain insight to how policies work or don't work, as the case may be, on the ground. And additionally, the options appraisal process will include officials making visits to stakeholders around Scotland to ensure opportunities for the workforce and those with lived experience to participate in all of that. So my commitment, my very clear commitment in all of this, has been to listen to the voices of lived experience, to ensure that stakeholders are involved, and we will continue to listen all the way through until we make the decision one way or the other. But I reiterate my point from earlier, no matter whether these services are in or out, we have to make sure those linkages are better for people.
Okay. So if we work on the basis that there's a parliamentary majority for the government in this parliament, will this legislation be passed if the government parties vote it through before decisions are made as to whether National Care Service would include social work?
We are voting on a framework bill, as Ms Clark knows. In that bill, there is the provision to move criminal justice, social work and children's services in if Parliament agrees to that.
Of that decision, because in terms of the Parliament.
I expect there to be scrutiny all the way through this. I have said to numerous committees, and I'll say to this one, we want to be open and transparent about all of this. And if there is a decision to move criminal justice, social work or children's services into National Care Service, of course there will be scrutiny, because there will be scrutiny in terms of the secondary legislation. And in all of this, as we move forward, we will convey our decisions to Parliament and to committees for full scrutiny. As I said earlier on, not only to this committee but to others, you know, my door is open in all of this, because I want to ensure that we get this right for the people of Scotland.
So you're saying delegated legislation will come to this committee? Thank you.
Was that a question?
I understood that's what the minister was saying, that we'd have delegated legislation that would come to Parliament, which presumably would mean this committee. I mean, whether it's this committee or another committee, there will be delegated legislation.
If I can be helpful here, in terms of the policy memorandum, because the bill comes with another suite of documents, and I'm not quite sure that everybody has looked at these to the degree. Section 30 of the bill requires the Scottish ministers to consult publicly about any proposed transfer relating to justice services using the enabling power before regulations are brought forward, and when laying draft regulations to transfer justice social work functions, the Scottish ministers must also lay before Parliament a summary of the process by which they consulted in relation to the function transfer and the responses that they received to that consultation.
Slightly different from delegated legislation coming to the Parliament, and whether it's this committee or indeed another committee, having the opportunity to scrutinise and indeed vote on that delegated legislation. Would you give an undertaking that you would bring delegated legislation?
I wonder if I'm very happy for the Minister to respond, but I'm just quite keen to keep questioning on track around the potential transfer for Just a Social Work into the National Care Service.
I hadn't planned to ask about this, but it was because of what the Minister said that I am pursuing that point. But it could be something we could pursue at a later date.
So, Convener, we don't have anybody from SGLD here at this moment from the legal side. What I will do is write to the committee and outline all of the processes, most of which are outlined within that policy memorandum. I'm not going to read the entire policy memorandum out to the committee, you'll be glad to hear, but we will outline all of this to you in writing about that process will work. But let me say to Ms. Clark and to others, I'm more than happy to continue to have that open door policy and to listen to what folk have to say on these issues, and we'll consider what folk have to say.
Thanks very much. Okay, I'm going to bring in Fulton MacGregor, followed by Russell Finlay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister. I hope, hope you're not too tired after.
I think we're probably all just a bit jaded this morning, Mr. MacGregor.
It's actually following on from Katie Clark's line of questioning and something that you'd said in response to the convener earlier, and that was that the Cabinet will decide at some point about whether justice services go over to the National Care Service. Can I just clarify, is that a decision, and I think you've already answered, is that a decision that they will go over, or is that the decision to consult, to go to consultation?
Well, we will consult, as I've said, and again, I would reiterate the points that I've just made around about consultation and 142 of the policy memorandum. Section 30 of the bill requires us to consult publicly about transferring any of those services, including justice services, using the enabling power. So we will consult. So, and we've laid that out quite clearly.
Yep. Thanks for clarifying that. You'll know that in these particular areas, justice and children and families, I'm not talking about the adult care social work, I'm talking about these two particular areas. It's not a particularly popular thought at this point, but obviously people want to be taken with the government if it's where they're going. But what I'm trying to ascertain is if there is a consultation, but the government have decided that it's a good idea, so the Cabinet have decided it's a good idea, and the consultation leads to a load of responses that are perhaps not for it, what weight will that be put on the decision, the final decision, before bringing legislation, if that makes sense?
Well, as always, government will look at consultation and consultation responses. What I would say to Mr. MacGregor, he said that some of these proposals are not popular. What I would say to Mr. MacGregor is I found a lot of folk out there in terms of the conversations that I've had where there is popular support for change. If you talk to frontline social workers, of which I've done a fair amount of, and Mr. MacGregor has seen me being questioned by folks in the social work cross-party group, for example. But if you talk to frontline social workers, many of them see all of this as an opportunity, because what they want to see is more freedom and autonomy for the front line. What they want to see is again, the spirit of the 1968 Social Work Act coming into play. Many of them feel at this moment that they're bound by eligibility criteria and by budgets rather than making the right decisions in terms of preventative support. So, I would say to Mr. MacGregor, it may well be that some stakeholders, and I know there are stakeholders out there that do not necessarily favour these proposals. There are also a lot of folk in the front line who do. But what I will say to Mr. MacGregor and to the committee as a whole, as always, we will analyse consultation responses, look at them and act accordingly.
Yeah, thanks, Minister, for that response. And taking you back to that cross-party group meeting, it was that I really appreciate your attendance. And I think that in that particular cross-party group meeting, a lot of the social work frontline staff who spoke were from the adult care services. But I have obviously, having worked in that area before, spoken to a lot of justice and children and family social workers over the last wee while, and I would say that there is trepidation just now, and that's just what I've found. But that's it's nothing new, though. We've spoken in this committee about that was an issue that was raised, you know, a long time ago about justice becoming into the health service, and it wasn't popular then and was resisted. So I just wanted to put that out there. But
if I can maybe come back on that point that Mr. McGregor made, because I recognise. You know, that sometimes folks are wary of change, but others do see opportunity. Can I say to Mr. McGregor and to the committee that the Cabinet decision will be taken on the basis of evidence collated by the sector? And I was clear at the social work cross-party group, and I want to be clear again today with the committee, that the social work profession should be and needs to be at the heart of shaping the future. We need to listen to the profession. That's what I have committed to do. That's why I've made all of the appearances that I have and why I've made the visits that I have to listen to what folk have to say.
Yeah, thanks, Minister. I don't doubt your commitment to that whatsoever. And just for the record, I mean, I think that it's very much an open discussion that we have to have, and it might be the best way. And that actually brings me on to my last line of questioning. It's about that. It's about what the benefits would possibly be and how it would maybe go over. And I'm wondering that obviously in the document it's justice and children's services, two very separate things. They work very closely together just now. Is it the government's intention that would both go over, or could it possibly be that children and families go over, but not justice? Or what's the thoughts around that? Do they both need to go or not go?
They don't both need to go. I think, let me give you another example, convener. You know, there's been a lot of discussion at committee around about what should be left out of all of this. And there are other things, you know, which are not going to be in NCS, but have very clear connections. And at the Social Justice and Social Work Committee the other week, there was argument from some that housing and homelessness should be in, for example. And, you know, that's not a proposal that's been put forward by the government. However, you know, what we do know is that there are very clear connections between care, social work, housing, and, you know, the list goes on. So what we are doing in that regard is making sure that the connections between NCS, whatever is out or whatever is in, has a clear connection with housing and homelessness. And obviously, committee members will understand that because of my previous role, I've got a real desire, it's a necessity to make sure that all of that is absolutely spot on right. So no matter what is out, what is in, you know, those connections have to be there. And does it have to be that both go in or both stay out? No.
That's really good to clarify that. And that actually brought me on to my final question, Minister, and it was about the linkages that you talked about, which I think that are very important. I would say that the linkages, I welcome the fact that justice and children are, and they're in the same bit of the bill here, because I think that the linkages between them are really, really important, and probably more so than between justice and adult service, adult care services, for example. But you just actually brought me onto the housing issue, and if that obviously wouldn't be coming over to the National Care Service, and that is a massive link that's required in justice, and probably one of the biggest areas of concern that you'll hear. But I think you've actually answered what I was going to ask you, because, convener, I was actually going to ask the Minister if he'd thought about how housing services and other local authority services would work into this, and he's actually answered it by saying that there would be those strong links.
Absolutely. And, you know, myself, my officials have spent a fair amount of time in terms of looking at the linkages and, of course, again, listening to the voices of lived experience and stakeholders. So if we look at housing and homelessness, you know, I'm in regular discussion with Shona Robison on these issues. And, you know, I've had a number of meetings to listen to housing and homelessness stakeholders, as folk could well imagine. And as the former chair of the Housing, Homelessness Prevention and Strategy Group, you know, I think that's incumbent on me. And what I would point out to the committee is, in terms of those linkages, we need to build on some of the past work that we have done, which, you know, has been fairly good work. So, as the committee is aware, I introduced Housing First here in Scotland, which ensured that there was a person-centred approach taken to ensure that not only was somebody housed appropriately, but all of the other services came into play around about them. And I don't have the most up-to-date figures. I said this yesterday, I should have looked them up last night, but we were busy with other things. You know, the tenancy retainment rate in terms of Housing First has been some 90%, which nobody expected. Why is that? Because we ensured that housing, social work, health, social care, addiction services and others were working together to make sure that that person-centred approach was there. Now, if we can do it in that regard, we can do it in other regards too and make sure that linkages are right. And beyond that, you know, what I would also say to the committee is that there is the legislation that will come into play in terms of homelessness around about public duties in terms of getting it right for people anyway, which of course is also beneficial in ensuring those linkages become the norm.
Thanks, Vassal. Sorry, convener, if I took a bit longer.
That's okay, that's fine. All relevant points to cover. We've got about 20, 25 minutes left, so I'm just going to bring in Russell and then followed by Jamie Green. Russell.
I'll be very brief. Thank you. Good morning. So the fundamental question from our perspective is whether a criminal justice social worker will be in or out of the proposed new National Care Service. Now, you don't know the answer to that. Can you even tell us or indicate which you think is most likely?
Convener, I think it would be very wrong of me to have sat here earlier on and say that we are doing all of the work in terms of research, options, appraisals, listening to stakeholders and the voices of lived experience, and for me to say what I think at this moment. What I will do, as I've done in all of the work that we've done, is listen to people and look at the evidence. It will be that that will guide us in the terms of our decision-making around about and around.
Civil service working on both potential scenarios just now?
Yes, of course. As I said to the committee earlier, no matter in or out, we have to make sure that all of this gels together anyway. So absolutely that work is going on to make sure that we get this right for people, whether in or out.
OK. And do you have any notion of timescale as to when we might know?
I think that the evidence is... I'll go through it all around about what will come into play in terms of supporting the decision. So we've commissioned that external research, as I have said, to understand the strengths and weaknesses of existing practice and where improvements can be made. That research is currently being procured, and that will go alongside a literature review, and we'll actively gather views, as I've said, from stakeholders, including staff, and the voices of lived experience. The options appraisal, this will bring stakeholders together to further co-design and analyse different options, resulting in understanding of the desirability and viability of each. And that this will help us inform an in-principle decision in autumn of 2023. And the final phase is that 12-week public consultation to seek views on the proposed approach, and this will commence in late 2023, that will inform a final decision around about April of 2024.
So just to recap, the procurement process, when is that due to conclude?
I'll take Ms. Dalrymple, please.
Sure. Thank you. Just to confirm that the procurement tender has now been awarded this week, so we expect that work to commence in January.
It's to a private organisation?
I can't provide any details, I'm afraid, at this stage around that, because the process is still confidential, as I understand
it. What we'll do is, once that confidentiality is out of the way, we'll write to the committee and let them know.
But going by the timescales, if all goes to plan, it'll be 14 months from now before we know whether criminal justice social workers in or out.
That's what I've just said to the committee.
That's just what I was trying to establish.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Okay, I'm going to bring in Jamie Green, followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Can I ask, Minister, did you follow the evidence session that we took on the 23rd of November?
I have followed many evidence sessions. I would be honest to the committee and say I haven't watched all of the sessions, but I've had transcripts and summaries, as the committee would well imagine, which has been my bedtime reading, Mr. Green.
I'm sure you'll look forward to it. I would commend perhaps watching the video of that session. I went into it with a very open mind. But I think it was fair to say that, having sat through the evidence from Social Work Scotland, COSLA, Unison and members of other social health and social care partnerships who gave evidence to us, it was difficult to come out with any positivity over the potential of the inclusion of community justice in the proposed National Care Service. There were a number of criticisms made around consultation prior to the bill being published, which I don't think have been addressed, and a number of very valid concerns around the structure of what any such integration might look like, particularly around people, funding, structures, leadership, and so on. I appreciate you haven't watched the session, but without having seen that session, I'm sure you'll understand what some of those criticisms might be. I wonder if you could respond to them.
I think that there have been some criticisms given to all committees, and some have been critical friends who have given their views. There are others, of course, who do not want change. And I think that would be fair to say. But change is required here in terms of National Care Service. We cannot continue in the same vein. We have changing demographics. We have a postcode lottery of care in Scotland, which is not good enough. And one of the things which is a little bit frustrating, I have to say, is the lack of voices of lived experience that at some of the committee sessions. And what I would say is that, you know, those voices, those folks who are in receipt of social work, social care, help and support, they are the folks that we need to be listening to, because they will rightly point out where the system doesn't work for them. And we have been on a 20-year journey of health and social care integration. And there have been improvements, but there are still implementation gaps. And I think one of the reasons why there have been those implementation gaps is because we haven't listened to people, and we haven't let people help us shape services. So I recognise, you know, that some folk don't want this change. But what I do say to the committee is that if you listen to the voices of lived experience, many of them are hungry for change. They want rid of the postcode lotteries. They want those implementation gaps plugged, and they want a system that works for them. And I come back to the point that I made to the convener earlier around about where the system doesn't work for some folk. And I come back to that lad that I was talking about earlier, at risk of offending. 15 different interventions, and yet it seems that this doesn't work for him, and we need to resolve those issues.
I think the question, though, is how do you resolve those issues? And the question that we'll be facing us all is whether a centralised approach to this, by removing that power and authority and probably funding from the current structures where services are delivered locally by local authorities through ring-fenced grant budgets from the Scottish Government, to some form of nationalised service and the implications around that. It's very unclear still where the money will flow, whether it will be diverted from or to, and which cohort of people will deliver the service. Because you talk a lot about lived experience, but what I get the impression is that we're not listening to is the lived experience of social workers themselves on the front line, who are telling us and have given us evidence as such, to quote one, that it is leadership, not structure, that is the most important. That was from Aberdeen City Health and Social Care Partnership. CLOSA themselves are concerned that removing justice social work from local authority responsibility will actually impede multi-agency working with other local authorities, and that a local approach is the best one. These services are best managed and delivered locally. So there is a real concern that nationalisation will result in effectively a privatisation of the service, where work currently being done by people paid and employed by the public service, this work will all be simply outsourced through a procurement process, a national procurement process, to a third party, perhaps even a commercial or private one. Is that a genuine risk?
No, there will be no privatisation of these services. And what I would say to Mr Green, because he talked of centralisation there, the National Care Service will balance the need for local flexibility by having care boards plan and commission care whilst providing national consistency through ministers being ultimately accountable. Now, why have we moved in that direction? Because people have told us that they want to see ministerial accountability. I should say to the committee that accountability has been way up there in terms of the discussions that have been had. And you will see from the Feely Review and from other work that folks do not feel that people are necessarily accountable as they should be for the delivery of these services. So people kind of believe, quite frankly, that I'm not accountable for the delivery of social work and social care services in Scotland at this moment. Folk around this table have written to me to intervene in social work and social care situations in their area, which I can't do because that is dealt with by other autonomous bodies at this moment. But the public have been quite clear, over 72% in terms of response to the consultation, that they want to see ministerial accountability. They also want to see local accountability strengthened as well, which we will do. But this is not centralisation. This is about national accountability, setting national high-quality standards, which should be applied across the board to ensure that those postcode lotteries disappear. But it is also about that local delivery, local flexibility, local innovation and local accountability.
Yep, I'm all for ministerial accountability. But you know, that doesn't address any of the practical questions that have been addressed to us that we don't have answers to. And it seems that no one has answers to really practical questions. For example, will all these social workers currently employed by local authorities be chooped over to some form of other government agency? And all of these remain known unknowns, given that we have real issues with retention and churn within the social work sector. Massive problems with resource to deliver local services. It's unclear how any of that will address what are clearly current shortfalls. And just before you do come on to that, is that I would also like to respond to the financial issue around this, because at the end of the day, money talks with all of this. The Minister will be acutely aware of what I think was quite a highly critical report from the Finance Committee, a unanimous report around the weakness of the financial memorandum of the bill for the NCS. So again, can I ask if the money will follow from the current status quo of grant funding to LAs, would that be redistributed to another agency or body, or would that money still continue to flow as is? But as you say, it's simply lines of accountability that are changing.
So let me answer those points. And let me start off with the point of churn, as Mr. Green puts it. And I agree, there is a lot of churn within social work. And without naming authorities, because it would maybe be a little bit naughty for me to do so, we know that there are folks who will leave one authority to go to another because pay and conditions in that other authority are much, much better. That causes real grief. That means that there are difficulties in some parts of the country in terms of recruitment and retention because some local authorities are paying much more or the conditions are better in those authorities. And what we need to do is to ensure that there is some kind of uniformity there and an improvement in terms of pay and conditions, which is not something that I can do at this moment in time, because that is not a matter for me. In terms of transfer of staff, it's by no means a foregone conclusion that local authority staff, for example, will need to transfer their employment. It remains the government's position that new local care boards will work collaboratively in partnership with the NHS local authorities, third and independent sectors, to improve support locally and nationally. And, you know, we will have the discussion with social workers, their professional bodies and others around about this as we move forward, as I've said. But I think that there is the opportunity for improvement here, not only in terms of pay and conditions, but also in getting career progression right too. Because one of the things which I've been told by care workers, but also by social workers too, is that often the opportunities are not there for career progression. And we need to do better in that front for the simple reason that we need to attract more folks into these professions. And for young people in particular, a number of whom I've talked to, as you can imagine, while pay and conditions is way up there, career progression, education, continuous professional development is also high in their agenda, and we need to get better at that too. And we have that opportunity.
And stress. It's huge amounts of stress.
Absolutely. And if we look at some of the survey work that has been carried out by the professional bodies, you will see that some of that stress is caused by the fact that folk feel bound by budgets and by eligibility criteria. And I come back to my point earlier around about creating that freedom and autonomy and being person-centred in terms of the support and changing the current situation where there is a huge amount of spend on crisis and moving to prevention. And that obviously reduces the cost of the public purse, but also reduces the human cost. And I think a lot, and I'm sure the committee has heard this from frontline social workers too, a lot of the stress that is felt is because folk do not feel that they are able to put in the right help and support at the right time. And that's what we need to change.
Thank you, Convener. Appreciate others. Last question.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Pauline McNeill, followed by Colette Stevenson. Just to remind members, that's coming up to 5 to the hour. I'm happy to extend the session to around about 10 past 11, but we've got four members coming in, so if I can ask if questions and answers can be fairly succinct. Pauline.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Thank you for your answers so far. So I think I'm hearing clearly what you're saying, that this is work in progress, consultation, you're treading carefully, you're working on the basis of recommendations. So that is very welcome. Just a follow-up on a question from Katie Clark, which I think is quite important for me anyway. So at some point, we'll decide on the general principles of the bill and the framework that you outlined and the duty to consult. So if you voted in favour of the general principles of the bill, what you're voting for then, is it just a duty, it's just you're voting so the government will consult, but ultimately you could be voting for the principle of the National Source Award Agency to be included in the National Care Service. That would be my worry about voting for the general principles, although obviously I support the ideas behind it.
Well, obviously you would be voting for that framework bill and the general principles of that bill. And as I've said to other committees, you know, that framework bill scenario was the way that we established the National Health Service. And then, you know, other aspects of that were slotted in order to make that or to fulfil that creation. So you are voting for the general principles of that framework bill. But that's not the end of all of this, as I've said, because at the end of the day, we will continue to speak to and listen to stakeholders and the voices of lived experience and, of course, committees and Parliament as we move forward in terms of our future decision-making around about those moves and possible secondary legislation.
Thank you very much. I note that you said in answer to Jamie Green that some frontline social workers were in favour of it, so I think that it's important to note that. And I will certainly be looking at it from that point of view. You may not be able to answer this now because, I say this because I remember there was a proposal under the Labour administration that looked a bit similar to this. And I wondered if you would write to the committee on this. And the reason I mention it is because at the time, there was uproar from the criminal justice social work. It never got off the ground because there was deep opposition to the centralisation of it. Now, I do acknowledge that this may be a different context because it's in the context of the National Care Service. I asked that question because I just like for accuracy to know if there's any similarities, and perhaps your officials could dig a wee bit into that. And I tell you, the other reason I'm asking is because when you answered Katie Clark in relation to where did this come from, I would have thought, although it's a recommendation, your natural instincts might have been not to go with it because it is controversial, even though you might work it out at the end of the day. So I'm not expecting an answer, but I wondered if you would give me an answer at some point.
Convener, I don't know the history of the previous proposal, but I'm quite happy to go and look at that. I'll maybe be able to fit in that reading over the course of the Christmas and New Year holidays. but, you know, we will have a look at that, and I'll write to the committee around about certain aspects. You know, I think that for some folk, some of the proposals are controversial that we are putting forward. But the key thing in all of this is the voices of lived experience. The voices of lived experience are the primary motivation for me getting up in the morning and doing this work, because they know what works for them and what doesn't work for them. And, you know, it may well be that something is controversial a decade plus ago, and then now it has its day. That's the way the world works at points, is it not? And I think that social work, including criminal justice social work, has changed dramatically since the last administration were in power. And I would say that, you know, it's only 10 years since I've left local government, and I can see massive changes in social work and criminal justice social work since I left a local authority. Now, some of that change, some folk would say was for the good. Others would say it's been for the bad. And I think one of the things, and I've talked about frontline social workers talking about eligibility criteria and budgets, I think it's also fair to say that many frontline social workers feel that social work has lost its voice at this moment, particularly in certain parts of the country. And I think, again, that's something that needs to be addressed. So I promise Ms McNeill that I will look back at the history over the course of the holidays. I'm lying if I'm not an anorak, and we'll respond as best we can in terms of the question about similarities or not.
Well, I really appreciate that answer. I mean, just for the record, I mean, I didn't have a strong view for or against at the time, and I don't now, but I did wanted to note, you know, there was quite controversial, and take your point that things have moved on, but thank you very much for the answer. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much, Pauline. I'll bring in Colette Stevenson, followed by Rona Mackay. Colette.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, Minister. There's a couple of questions I'd like to ask you, but one of the big things, and you've talked about how there has to be consistency taking it forward if you were to include children and families and criminal justice in with the NCS. But from the evidence that we've taken, and even from my own experience working with children's care homes as well, is there seems to be a sort of deep mistrust with the people, you know, with lived experience going through the social care system of social workers. And that was picked up on in an evidence session that we took a few weeks back when we were doing bail and release as well. So in terms of reform and changing that culture, I mean, would it be something, and if this is something that you would think about, is even changing the name of a social worker? Because there's a big stigma attached to that as well. And I mean, I even know from having been a counsellor with South Lanarkshire, there was even somebody had the name of Homemaker, which is quite an old-fashioned name, but there just seemed a lot of the kids that I worked with in the care experience system had a really deep mistrust of social workers.
Convener, I could probably get myself into a lot of trouble if I was going to try and redefine names of folks' roles at this moment in time. But, you know, I'm not averse to having these conversations. I think, you know, I get where Ms. Stevenson is coming from around about some folk mistrusting social workers. But I also have to say that I've seen some very good examples of real trust being formed between social workers and those folks that they are supporting. And I think the element of mistrust often comes into play because a social worker has come in to play at crisis point rather than at prevention point. And that's why, you know, we are looking at a number of things at this moment in time, and we'll do further test of change work to see how we can improve things further in that front. So I met with folks from Fife a couple of months back, and I intend to visit there, but we've not managed to slot it in yet. They've got a pilot going on at this moment in two areas of Fife, where basically they have given social workers a clean sheet, basically to do what is required to achieve good outcomes for people, obviously within reason, but basically a blank sheet. That seems, and it's at very early stages, but that seems to be already having very positive impact on people because the social workers have been freed up and, you know, have that autonomy and are not bound by some of the strictures there that were there, which could often lead to that mistrusting situations. So I think that that work in terms of that activity and other work that is going on in terms of test of change, we need to look at. Because I think, you know, again, I come back to my point around about the 1968 Act, that community social work ethos, that freedom and autonomy worked really, really well. And some of the changes that have taken place since then, particularly in the 80s, it's drawn away from that. So let's see what this test of change work can do. I think that inevitably will lead to greater trust again.
Thank you. And just following on from that, there's one other question. It's more a technical one, really. You sort of touched upon the fact that social workers, if they were to move over to the NCS, then they would basically be getting two-peed over. However, there's 32 local authorities and they've all got varying degrees of procurement framework contracts, all of them probably staggered one way or another through social work. How would that work going forward?
Well, again, you know, as I said, we are not talking necessarily about wholesale transfers of staff. I've said that to every committee. But what we do need to do, no matter what, really, is get to a point where we are stopping the kind of churn that Jamie Green talked about earlier and getting the right pay and conditions levels for staff across the board in order to aid recruitment and retention within social work and within social care. In terms of procurement, and I know that you've said be brief, convener, I could wax lyrical, or probably not quite so lyrical, for hours around about our ambitions for ethical procurement. But maybe rather than me doing that, which I've done elsewhere, maybe I should just write to the committee around about ethical procurement.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
That would be welcome, Minister. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you, Colette. I'll bring in Rona Mackay, and then very briefly, we've got time, Katie Clark. Rona.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister.
Good morning.
Well, first of all, can I say I think this session's been very reassuring on a number of counts. Some of the concerns we heard were that, you know, witnesses didn't want to think this has been rushed through without them having a chance to be listened to and to be part of the co-design. And from what you've said with the timescale to my colleague, Russell Findlay, you know, you are giving that time. You know,
this
we're talking.
No,
yeah.
No.
Yeah. And I think that's very reassuring. The other thing that we heard was from witnesses was that the status quo wasn't an option, you know, so pretty much across the board people realised that they wanted something done. But I'm very reassured that you've been listening to people with lived experience and all that, and I'm sure other stakeholders will be. So my question is basically, if pressure comes to you from local authorities not to include justice social work in the NCS bill, and if that, you know, that pressure is mainly based on maybe some financial fears that local authorities have or whatever, are you confident that you can answer those concerns that local authorities might have?
I will try and answer everybody's concerns, and I will try to find solutions to all that is put in front of us. And I know that, the Finance Committee went over this in some depth, as have others. You know, local authorities have a concern around about the movement of budgets. And I said at the Finance Committee, you know, we will try and make that cost neutral. And, you know, I would reiterate that point. I want to ensure that we cooperate and collaborate to the max with local authorities. Unfortunately, on some of these issues at the moment, COSLA are not at the table. I hope that will change because they need to be at the table too. And in terms of the co-design of National Care Service, you know, others will be at the table. So they need to be at the table too on all of the issues, not just some of them, all of the issues, so that their views are heard too. But, you know, as I said, I think there is worry around about resourcing. There always is, let's be honest. That's the way of the world. But, you know, as I said at the Finance Committee, we will try and make this as cost neutral as possible. Okay, for local authorities.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. We're just on 10 past, but I'm quite happy to bring in Katie Clark if we can keep it as succinct as possible.
Yes, I will be brief. And I note, Minister, that you say you're going to write to us about what you call ethical procurement, but don't you accept that commissioning is tendering, which leads to outsourcing and privatisation?
No, I don't necessarily accept that at all. I think that at this moment, you know, we have situations or have had situations where a huge amount of the tendering has gone on and the contracts that have been won have been based on price. And I think that there are omissions from that contracting, which I'll be honest with you, has frustrated me over the years. When I was in a local authority, I should say that not everything we did was based on price, I hasten to add, where there should be elements put in to those procurements, fair work being the main example. And, you know, there are other elements too that, you know, we are looking at that can be built in to all of that. What I would say is that currently, in terms of care, there is a mixed economy. And let's be honest, the third sector play a hugely important role in all of this. And I'm quite sure that nobody wants to omit the third sector from anything as we move forward. An ethical procurement will drive up transparency. And of course, bring that fair work into play. But I will write in some depth to the committee around about ethical procurement as we move forward.
If there was a decision to bring social work into the National Care Service, it would lead to a significant increase in tendering. You accept that? That seems to be what you're saying.
No, I don't accept that at all. But again, we'll lay that out in some depth in writing.
In the spirit of it being coming up for the festive season, I'm going to allow Fulton McGregor to come in with a very final, very quick final question, and then we will need to bring the session to a close.
Thanks, Convener. I wasn't actually expecting to get back in, so I do appreciate that. A final question is on the how you're going to capture the lift experience that you've spoken about, Minister. I actually think you're doing a fantastic job as a government with this in terms of the adult social care part of it, because I've seen a lot of the work that you're doing and the lived experiences coming through loud and clear in relation to that. And we heard a lot of that at that cross-party group meeting that you referred to. But for this particular committee, I'm just wondering if you've got any thoughts, and it might be to write to us, because we're coming to the end of the session, about how you might get the lived experience of criminal justice service users on their view and whether, you know, they quite like the services just now, or whether they would quite like the workers who support them to be part of the National Care Service. And I know you spoke about one individual that the 15 folk involved with him, but I'm just wondering if you've got any ideas how you might do that on a larger scale with justice service users, like what you're doing with the adult service users just now.
So there are a number of things which are going on at the moment. And, of course, we have listened to folk all the way through this with a huge amount of engagement across the board, not only by me, but also officials. And we've had, for example, the National Care Service Forum, which brought a huge amount of people in person to Perth Concert Hall, but also a lot of folk online and a lot of stuff before that. We're now at the stage where we're recruiting for lived experience panels, lived experience expert panels, should I say. I think at the moment we've got over 450 folk applied. You know, we're encouraging folk from right across the country with different experiences to play a part in all of that. But beyond that, recognising that that's not for everyone, we are also involved in targeted engagement, supported by the third sector, and that will continue. Also, people with lived experience will also be able to participate in the option appraisal that I talked about. Option appraisal workshops will be led by the Scottish Government, specifically for people with lived experience of justice social work. You know, I am absolutely adamant that we continue to listen to the voices of lived experience all the way through our journey here. I talked earlier about the implementation gaps that we all know that exist in service delivery. And I truly believe that the only way that we can plug those implementation gaps is by having folk with lived experience helping us shape those services along with frontline staff.
Thank you, that's reassuring. Thanks,
thanks very much indeed. So I'm going to bring this session to an end. Thank you very much indeed, Minister, and your officials for joining us today. And I'm just going to briefly pause the meeting to allow the Minister and his officials to leave. Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed, members. So the next agenda item is to return to our consideration of the issue of legislative consent for the Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill. And this follows the evidence that we took from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans. And I refer members to paper number 3. And you'll also see in your papers that the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service has also provided us with its correspondence with the Northern Ireland Office. So I'm now going to open up the discussion to members, and then we will consider what recommendation we want to make to the Parliament on legislative consent. So I'm just going to ask any members if you would like to come in. Jamie?
Before I do, can I just ask procedurally what we will be asked to do, because that may affect what I will say next, if that makes sense.
So obviously we heard from the Cabinet Secretary in relation to the legislative consent memorandum in which the Scottish Government is recommending that the Scottish Parliament should not consent to the relevant provisions in this bill as set out in the draft motion. So our role today is to consider the content of the memorandum and decide whether or not we will agree to not consent or otherwise. So I really just at this stage want to open up to members if you have any queries, comments or questions that you'd like to make. And from there, we'll then I'll then formally ask the question around the LCM.
OK. In that case, I'm happy to give way to other members. And if it's possible, come back with a summary of what I'd like to say thereafter, if that's OK.
That's fine. Katie, then Rona.
I was going to say that I think we should support the position put forward by the Cabinet Secretary that we don't give consent. However, at the last meeting, I got the impression that Conservative MSPs were going away to, use their connections to see if some of the concerns could be addressed. So I will listen carefully to what's said, but on the basis of what was said at the previous hearing, I would have thought that should be where we were, given the gravity of the concerns being raised.
Okay, thank you, Katie. Rona.
Thanks, Convener. I'll keep it brief. I think there's two aspects to this bill, and if you first of all leave aside the constitutional question, the first question is I believe it's a very bad bill. Mm-hmm. I think it shuts the door on justice for people looking for justice for, you know, what happened decades ago in Northern Ireland. And I think it's in no one's interest to do it. So I think it's the actual premise of the bill is very bad. You know, constitutionally, I think it's a no-brainer. The response from the Lord Advocate, for instance, just one line of her response said, the bill in its current form engages a number of areas over which I have constitutional responsibility and does so in a manner novel to Scots criminal law. So this would be new ground and not good new ground. So I would strongly recommend that we do not consent to this.
Okay, thanks very much. And just for members, just as a reminder, the reasons, I think, Rona, you've really just kind of outlined part of this, but the reasons that consent is not recommended are twofold. Firstly, that the government is of the view that the bill, as it's currently drafted, is incompatible with the Scottish Government's view that those who have suffered during the Troubles are able to obtain justice, and that those who committed offences during that time are appropriately held to account or punished. And secondly, the bill makes novel and unwelcome changes to the functions and responsibilities of the Lord Advocate as head of the systems of criminal prosecution and investigation of deaths in Scotland. So those were the two sort of key reasons that the government was recommending that consent was not given. Would anyone else like to come in, Colette?
I totally agree with Rona on this as well, and I don't want to give consent for this to go forward. The other thing that stood out for me was the financial implications as well, that between 35 to 50 million per year, that's
it's not Scottish
government. No, I know, but it's still public purse as well. And it's quite substantial as well, and there's other costs incurred in with that as well. But yeah, absolutely, at the heart of it, it's about the victims here from historic troubles over in Ireland as well, getting justice.
Mm-hmm. So, okay. Thank you very much. Pauline?
Briefly, Convener, I agree with what's been said. I think there are two matters. First of all, the actual substance of the bill itself doesn't seem to me even to have widespread support in Northern Ireland itself, which I did check after I left committee the last time. So that gives me cause for concern that the subject matter is not really settled in terms of a consensus going forward, and therefore the undermining of the powers in this Parliament therefore can't really be justified when the essence of it itself it doesn't have full consensus amongst those who have an interest and are affected by it. For me, anything, having argued strongly for devolution before even I got here, I've always been very strongly protective of the powers, and to overturn to hand those powers for those purposes, I would absolutely want to be sure we were doing it for reasons that I felt were correct and justified, and in this case I don't, and therefore I'll be supporting the government.
Thank you, Pauline. Thulton?
Thank you, Convener. I wasn't going to particularly speak in this item, but I won't speak just for the sake of it, but I think given the gravity of what we've been asked to decide today, it's important to put my own views on the record, and that's simply to say that I agree completely with what my colleagues Rona Mackay, Colette Stevenson and Pauline McNeill have already outlined. So I just wanted that simply on the record, Convener.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. Russell?
Yeah, thank you. So I agree with Colette Stevenson in that this is indeed about justice for victims, but I think I disagree with Rona, that who's got a sort of fundamental more opposition to it in principle. It's worth bearing in mind that the intent behind this is to achieve justice and answers for those who've spent decades not being able to get any. And it's a very sensitive and unique situation. It's worth bearing in mind that when I spoke to the Cabinet Secretary in the evidence session, he seemed to agree with the principle of a UK-wide approach. So I think it would be somewhat hasty to oppose this because I think it would be more important that we could seek to overcome any incompatibility or issues between the various parts of the UK. So, thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else want to come in? Jamie?
And thank you. Can I thank members for their contributions? I feel like I'm summing up a debate. I'm not. But it is an issue that I've spent some time on. So, first of all, just want to make clear, I'm not, whatever I say next is not on behalf of the UK government or the Northern Ireland office or any other UK minister or secretary of state. It's purely my own views and the views of the party here within the Scottish Parliament. I think our party generally is supportive of the concept of the establishment of the Independent Commission for Reconciliation and Information Recovery. That's not to say that every aspect of the bill is perfect in its current state, but like all bills, as we know only too well, go through an iterative process of scrutiny, and that bill will go through that process in Westminster duly, and they also have the benefit of a second chamber, which we don't. But I think the clue is in the name. The commission is one of reconciliation and information recovery, and I personally believe that these are quite important steps forward in the peace process. And I think the argument that was made that both sides of the political spectrum in Northern Ireland have some opposition to it, I think by its very nature demonstrates perhaps its necessity. Because obtaining truth and closure are, I think, key pillars of that process. And this, if this independent commission, and it is independent and will be independent, is able to do that and continue some of that work, then that's important. It is a five-part bill with 58 clauses. It's quite complex. And whilst there are some elements of it which are controversial, I assume, particularly those around immunity, perhaps even the issues of prisoner release and so on, but these have been issues that have been controversial for many years as part of the peace process. There are other positive aspects around the investigation of deaths, fatal accident inquiries and so on. So there are many aspects to the bill, and I think it's very easy just to take a very simplistic one-sided view on it. I'm very open-minded to what the bill is trying to achieve, and I feel it's appropriate to let it make its progress. On the specifics of what we've been asked to do within the context of legislative consent, I think I wanted to comment just on three things. The government actually gave three reasons for opposition, I would say, rather than two. The first was around concerns made by the Lord Advocate, which I think were duly made and quite well made. And given that at the time we didn't have those concerns on paper, looking at the correspondence from the Lord Advocate to the Secretary of State in the UK government, it is clear that those concerns are quite well laid out. But equally, in that letter, it does go on to offer what I think is a pathway through that. Indeed, the Lord Advocate herself talked about a memorandum of understanding with each United Kingdom prosecution authorities in relation to referrals, for example. So I think it seems that there's a genuine constructive willingness on the part of the Lord Advocate, not to put words in her mouth, to find a solution to any conflict that may arise between her role as head of independent role of head of public prosecutions in Scotland and interaction with the bill and the powers that Pauline McNeill spoke of. And I don't think it's quite as simple as today handing over powers from Scotland to another jurisdiction. It sounds like there's an ongoing conversation to be had there, and I think we should allow that to make its progress. I would note, naturally, it is disappointing we haven't had the response to that, and I'm hoping that when that is made available, we will have sight of it. The second point was around ECHR compliance and the legal and potential legal implications of the bill and human rights law. In the evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary, I did question that, and I feel like it was more of an opinion rather than anything else. The Cabinet Secretary was unable to point us in the direction of any specific published views or advice on this, so it seems to be perhaps somewhat of a smokescreen. But the third, and probably the one that worries me most, would be the political disagreement with it, because the government are concerned that their primary reason for not offering legislative consent is that they believe that as the bill, as currently drafted, it's worth noting, is incompatible with the Scottish Government's view that those who have suffered during the Troubles are able to obtain justice. So that sounds to me more like a policy difference of opinion rather than one of legality. That is, of course, based on the bill as drafted. The bill will go through a process, and I would expect all parties, including members of the government's own party, who represent them in the UK Parliament, to you know, do that accordingly and put our trust in them to do that properly. So, for that reason, it would be our bench's view that we should offer consent to the passage of this, to let it run its course and work through the many issues which I've mentioned. And I think that holding it back at this stage would be unhelpful in the process. So we would not agree to any recommendation to withhold consent. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much, members. That's been really helpful. Just from my own perspective, just to add in a few personal comments of my own, I think in relation to just the point that you were outlining, Jamie, in relation to the correspondence between the Lord Advocate and the Secretary of State, I note that her last correspondence was on the 10th of October, I think, when she wrote to the new Northern Ireland Secretary and I think outlined some suggestions around the bill. And as far as I'm aware, she's not had any response to that. And just on that note, the bill is very nearly complete and through its journey. So that gives me some concern that there's been nothing back from the UK government in response to her correspondence. The second thing just to point out is the some comments from the Council of Europe Commissioner for Human Rights that, and I quote, the bill runs the risk of being found to be non-compliant with human rights, and indeed the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission also expressed grave concerns about the bill in terms of its incompatibility with the Good Friday Agreement, and I think the Cabinet Secretary alluded to that in his statement when he joined us a couple of weeks ago. And finally, I'm quite uncomfortable with the notion that the ICRIR would have a role within Scotland that potentially impacts on people's access to justice, whatever that might be. And also, I'm very uncomfortable with the notion that the role and function of the Lord Advocate could potentially be affected. Okay, so thank you very much indeed. So the question now is that does the committee agree with the Scottish Government that the Scottish Parliament should not consent to the relevant provisions in this bill as they have been set out in the Scottish Government's draft motion? So I'm just going to go around the table. I think that's probably the best thing to do. And if you can indicate your position. So I'll start with you, Russell.
As to whether to support it or...
Do you agree with the government's position that we should not give consent?
No.
Okay, thank you. Colette?
I agree. I don't think we should give consent.
Okay. Thank you. Jamie?
No.
Agree with the government's position.
Okay, thank you. Katie?
I agree with the government's position, particularly because of the concerns being raised by the Lord Advocate.
Thank you. Pauline?
I exactly agree with Katie Clark on this. Nothing okay. more to say.
Thank you very much. Rona?
I agree with the government's position.
Okay. And I also agree with the government's position. Okay.
So we record that in the report.
Yeah. That's fine. Thank you, members. So what will happen now is that we will compile a report that will be presented to Parliament.
Could I make a small request just to the clerks? Often these SSIs or LCMs get waved through quite easily in the chamber. I presume this will come to a vote of the Parliament in plenary at some point, and it'd be nice to know when that's coming up so that we can keep our eye out for it.
Yeah, that's correct, Mr. Green. It will come before Parliament, and it will be up to Parliament to decide, and that may be on a vote if necessary. And of course, as soon as we've got some information on the timings of that, we'll let the committee know as far in advance as we can.
Thank you.
Okay. And just one final question for members. Are you content to delegate to me the publication of the report that summarises the outcome of our deliberations on the LCM? Happy with that? Okay, thank you very much. So the issue will now move, as we were saying, to the Chamber for all members to decide based on our report. So that completes our final business for the year, and I'd like to take this opportunity to wish all members and our staff, our clerks and other staff all the very best for the festive season. I hope you all have a very happy and peaceful Christmas and New Year. And can I also take the opportunity just to thank all of our witnesses who have given both informal and formal evidence to the committee this year. It's greatly appreciated. So thank you very much indeed. And we'll now move into private session.